Well, what's up, everybody? I'm Sir Phobos, and welcome back to Mordheim, City of the Damned, back in that damn city. So what I'm doing today is a little bit different. Instead of, we're going through raising a warband from scratch, I wanted to, talk about one of the warbands that I've played for a while and, haven't done any videos for, and it's pretty close. It's pretty close to a max level warband. It's my Skaven warband here. So instead of going through the process of building it up from scratch, I wanted to show off a warband that I've worked on for a long time, or for a while now, and my thought process behind them, and what they do and how they do it. I thought that would be fun. I like this warband. I think I've mentioned it in videos. I am a fan of the Skaven. It's a strong warband. I haven't lost with this one yet. And they are consistently very, very strong. So I'll show kind of like what I did when I built them. And this warband I did build from the ground up. I started at, level 0 or whatever, level 1, and built them up. So I have my Assassin Ad up, he's my leader. I have 2 Night Runners as my heroes. I did pick up Poison Wind Globadier, which is DLC for the Destruction Armies. Chaos and Skaven. The Globadier is so busted. I have a Black Skaven, who actually I don't like at all, and he's actually not maxed out right now, because I hate him so much. I might take him out of the warband, and then all my henchmen are actually Warp Guard, and this is the configuration that I've played with, and built up towards. I do have a Rat Ogre that I don't use, because I don't like impressives in general. But I'll talk about that. These warriors are clustered around their wagon, making them a very attractive target. Come on. There it is. Around 70% or so, it lags for a second. So this is going to be, it should be a relatively easy mission. We're both clustered around the cart. It is brutal difficulty. And all the difficulties mean for Mordheim is that the enemy has more health and does more damage. That's actually not too bad at all. How my warband works, my Skaven warband, it's an anvil kind of warband. It's a very tanky warband. All my Warp Guard and almost all my heroes are designed around one-handed weapons and shields, high melee resistance, so they're hard to hit, and then high dodge. I'm thinking we're going to try to fight right in here. Or just right out here on the streets. I would prefer here, because it's harder for him to get around and flank me, whereas if I'm here, they can come, depending on how spread out they decided to go. So we're gonna try to cluster in here and force him to fight me in there. So how I went about it is I used the Night Runners and the my Assassin Ad up there. They have really high agility, really high weapon skill. They make great melee resistant tanks. They're hard to hit, and then if you do hit them, if you get lucky on that RNG. They have high dodge. They're built around that. They have all their talents are giving them melee resistance or dodge, essentially. So they have a sidestep, which gives them, it's a stance that lets them do 3 dodge attempts because they haven't mastered. And that's what they do. They are the main tanks of the army. And they do that very, very well. For whatever reason, the AI prefers to go for your heroes, especially your leader. So if I line all my guys up, like all my tanks, in a row, they'll go go to whoever my leader is in the line and try to attack him, and he's the hardest to hurt. It's weird. I don't know why the AI does that. They don't strike for the closest enemy. They'll strike for your leader. It's, you know, it's a quirk of the AI, and you know, maybe we'll see that here. Outside of that, primarily they're built for tankiness. Right after that, they're built for crit. So I put everything else into accuracy after, you know, they max out weapon skill, basically. Oh, and they're built for leadership. Oh, goodness. There's their stats. So you can see, this is the warp guard. I favored agility. I favor leadership in the mental stats, and then weapon skill. I go leadership because failing leadership tests is so annoying. nothing will make the game go so much slower than failing a fear or terror test. And Skaven do that really, really well. They fail those tests really, really well. So actually, gear optimization-wise, too, I use pendants to give them higher. Because even with max leadership, they still have, a 60% chance to... Or a 60% chance to succeed at those tests. Yeah, so, early in the game, fighting undead is just terrible for Skaven. I got my butt kicked several times. Just because I would fail. The RNG would not be on my side, and... A vampire would just by himself roll up into my army, cause a terror test, and my guys would fail it. And then they would, even if I kill the vampire, it would be that terror test would be failed for the rest of the match. So they, were useless. It was terrible. Or a fear test like that. So it's really annoying. So I prioritize passing that test, those tests whenever I can. And that's why I use pendants over something like amulets. My army is all in cloth. They have no armor absorption, even though they have shields. The shields are just for the resistances, basically. All my warp guard use maces. To give them extra chances to hit. And then all my heroes, for the most part, my tank, my other three heroes, the Night Runners and the Assassin Adept, use swords for extra crit. So the idea is the enemy can't hurt my guys, can't hit them, and then my guys swarm around them. Skaven actually have a passive called Swarm that gives me extra hit and crit. And they're looking to just win through attrition, essentially. And that works out really well for me. You do get a lot of critical hits, which helps a lot, because they aren't a high damage army, the way I have them decked out. And then getting stuns is actually tremendous, because that makes it so any other melee hits automatically hit, and then it ups your critical chance on a target that's already stunned. So it snowballs if you can get those in there. And I was not expecting that, Mr. Man. I was not expecting you up here. So this isn't great. I was expecting at least one turn. Oh, he's going to make me look like an idiot and just wreck my poor boy here. I was not expecting them to be on my butt like that. Oh. Dirty, 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 dirty men. Okay. We're gonna be fine, though. It sucks because I got crit, so he has open wounds now, so he has less chance to hit. But, we'll pull this out. Now, the other two heroes, what they're based around... See, now this guy is... He's done for. You're done for, Ovis. You're done. The Globedeer, which I... If you can get Globedeers, just do it. They are amazing. he's based around being a support and shooty hero. So he's got the Warplock pistols, which are great weapons. And he's designed just to be support, essentially. I mean, he, on average, will do more damage in a match than just about anyone else in my warband, if I'm just having him shoot. But you can see, since my poor boy here, Mr. Creep, got his ass handed to him, he's going to be relegated to healing a little bit here. Yeah, the Globedeer can heal, too. He's, as far as I know, the only person on the Skaven warband that can, I'll take all this crap. I don't think I needed to fuck that guy for the other one, right? No. Okay. And actually, I will stay right here. Right? Yeah. We'll stay there. I don't know what this Yahoo the Mutant's gonna do here. Oh, he's stupid, too. Yeah, he gets a skill that can heal, which is, it's really, really good. So when something goes wrong like that, or I wasn't expecting to be, you know, turn to charge before my army got to act, it gives me a chance to recover. And since I'm gonna recover, I'm gonna kind of slowly advance here. Let them come funneling at me. So the Globedeer, he's gonna be my support, Skaven. And he, like I said, he's really strong. Even just shooting, he's really strong. Like, I'm contemplating getting rid of my stupid Black Skaven and just going to Globedeers because of how good he is. Now my Black Skaven, he's decked out to be like the executioner of the army. He's based around charging and then just doing tremendous amounts of damage. And he does do that. Like, he does, like, in a single turn, I can do, you know, 300 points of damage easy. Just, you know, he'll charge in, you know, he has Mighty Charge mastered, so it's 100% damage on the charge. With high crit and all this stupid, you know, Black Skaven passive is extra armor negation, which is really strong too. Like, he does stupid amount of damage. You know, it's silly. And he can charge in, disengage, charge again, you know. But he's got no survivability with his setup. You can see that's healing 30, and it does a huge radius. Like, it's super, super good. There is a downside to it. It can shave off an offense point for a turn. You know, some stuff like that. It's whatever. The Globedeer is really, really good. So I just heal 90 to everybody, basically, in my warband. let's see what it was. It has three different effects that it can do, and I actually got all three of them. It prevents switch weapons, minus 15 to jump, climb, whatever, and minus 1 offense points. Yeah, it's not bad. It's for one turn. It's not a huge downside, especially for being able to heal. And having two Globedeers would just, you know, double all the goodness there. So yeah, so my Blacksmith, the thought process behind that was my tanks would get in there, hopefully crit and stun somebody, or at least hold them down, and then he would just charge in and finish them off. The reality is, it's not working out super great for him. Either it takes too long to actually get him into that position to do that safely, or I try to overextend him to get him to do damage, and he just gets his ass handed to him, and it doesn't work out great for me. So you can see, you know, 33% chance to hit me, and then he's just getting sucked up. If he does, you know, the RNG does hit me, the dodge rolls usually save him. The biggest thing that wrecks this warband, as you could see, is either being caught unaware, like, oh, I wasn't prepared, and my poor boy just got his face crit. That puts me in a bad spot. Or having the RNG go really, really bad and you get stunned. Like, I have, I think 5 out of actions in this warband total. Nobody's been actually hurt. You know, no permanent injuries. But I think 3 of those were actually on my assassin ad up here. And actually, I'll do courage, because I have the extra strategy points, which just, it's more leadership against fear and terror tests than all alone tests, because that's something that can get me. Yeah, I have like 5 total out of actions. 3 of them are on my assassin ad up, where like I was just being dumb, scouting around or something. He got charged, unprepared, and then got his butt handed to him. Because he would get swarmed. And, you know, he's not designed to take a hit. He's designed to be a wall, and if he's not set up to do that, he gets his butt kicked. So you do gotta play careful. In the early game, I did cheese a little bit. It looks like he might just be up there edge guarding. And we'll just go ahead and move here now. Like in the early game, if I was fighting a warband that was like hard or brutal, like I would take those missions early on in the game too, but I would cheese a lot more. Like I would find a spot that I could really hold up in. Yeah, he's just standing up there. I would make a bottleneck. And I would just put my leader or my leader and one of my night runners there. To defend it. Can I scoot around him? Perfect. And then I would have everyone else switch to ranged weapons. And then I would just defend there and let the computer stupidly funnel into me to get killed. And I mean that it works out well. It's not super fast, and it's not super fun, but it, you know, if you're in a position where you have to do that, you can. It's like everyone in my army has an offhand ranged weapon. That's a nice thing about the Skaven. You know, you can give them the shuriken, or you can give them warplock pistols if they're heroes. And that works out really, really good. The warplock pistols in particular are really strong weapons. They have high damage. And they, if you do hit, they apply a debuff that makes it easier to hit again. You know, you get like an additional 3% or 2% chance to hit for each stacking debuff of warblock pistol ammo you get on them. So it's really good. Yeah, so that's, you know, that's how the warband rolls here. Basically, I use my heroes up front. They, you know, take the hits. They get it tied up. The warp guard will swing around and swarm, and then my Blackshaven will come in to execute, and my Globedeer will stand in the back and support, either through tremendous shooting or lobbing globes. He does have other globes. He's got the poison globe, of course, which I rarely use because it seems like it messes with me more than anything else, unless I'm defending a choke point or something like that, and I don't plan to advance very far. Because it creates a huge, like, carpet of poison that's a pain in the ass. I use the warp globe, which will put a debuff. 1 of 3 debuffs on the enemy. They're all super useful. One is either less stun resistance, less crit resistance, or less melee resistance. Which are all super, super good. And then the other one I have is the enrichment globe here, which does the opposite of the warp globe as a bonus to my guys. It doesn't stack, so I can only do 1, but, you know. The other thing about the... I wanted to keep healing. My boy's not... He's not super healthy yet. I want to get him back to full, just in case. The other thing is, the Globedeer is completely immune to his globes. His own globes. And enemy globes. He's immune to all globes. So you can't heal him. And you can't buff or debuff him at all. So I'm sure there's other builds you can do with the Globedeer. like he has a lot of talents that seem like melee focused, and then you could just drop the globe on him, like at his feet, because he's immune to all that crap. I don't know how good that is. I've never played with it much. He's really, really good as a ranged character. So that's how I play him. He has high ballistic skill, and so he's really, really good. I gave him all the talents to lower reload cost and do aim shots. So he can shoot effectively into melee too. It's no problem. A new round has started. So yeah, that's how this warband rolls. And I mean, as you can see, like they've only sent a couple guys to smash into me face first, and it did not go well for him. Immediately swarmed by Skaven, cut down, and you know, we're gonna venture out here and try to find him. There's a Doomweaver. A stupid cultist. So this guy, I have a sneaking suspicion he's just going to stay up there for the rest of the game. For some reason, I don't know what it is about the Mordheim AI. A lot of NPCs will edge guard and then just stay there. I don't know if they're actually getting stuck or what the issue is, but like when they're on an elevation. At a point where you could jump down, like they will just stay up there, and it happens a lot. Like they just won't come down. So I don't know. We'll see. Typically, if he was going to come down, he would have done it already. But like I said, we'll see. let's see. Secondary talents. My Night Runners also have combat savvy, which increases melee resistance on an ally. So if they get, you know, if they're stuck in combat for a while, or if they're preparing for a heavy charge, the Night Runners can use combat savvy on each other to up their melee resistance, because it is a little bit lower than my assassin add-up, and it helps. That's the percent to see if they get hit. Did he jump down? Maybe. Or he went inward? He went somewhere. I don't know. Okay, he moved, which is different from what they normally do. So, I guess he was not edgeguarding. Or something I did changed what his script was going to be. Sometimes when you are... like a protective bubble for my other dumb heroes. Sometimes that's what it takes to get the AI to move and do stuff. You have to move around and it'll change what their plan is. Otherwise, like if you just keep defending a spot, the AI will sometimes get locked into a similar situation where if you're not moving, they're in a position where they're not going to move. And the game will just go nowhere. Like, you have to, like, end your turn somewhere else. You have to, go down, approach them, and, you know, change how they see things. And you can actually... when you're cheesing the AI, that's one of the things you can do. Like, if you're defending a location, you can try to lure them into that location by doing things like that. So their Doomweaver ran at me with his dagger by himself, because he's a smart boy. Smart chaos boy. Not casting any spells. I don't know what he's doing. He thought he was going to get me, I guess. He was feeling strong with that extra like 35% damage. He's wearing heavy armor too. So we're just gonna come over here and we'll shoot him up. Boom. Yeah, he's wearing heavy armor and we don't have, see, it's almost 50% damage reduction. You can see he does a tremendous amount of damage fairly reliably when you're doing the aim shots. And he does have a high crit chance too. You see it's almost 30%. So on average, he should get in there. And we'll use our boy here too. Kind of show what he does. Ouch. He got counterattacked. And then disengage. Bloop. Can I not get another one? Oh, it'll be four that time. Alright, that's fine. He got hit. And we'll end his turn, doesn't matter. So yeah, ideally you would charge in, disengage, and charge back in. Finish it off. I can also use Black Hunger, which he doesn't have mastered yet. I'm waiting to master that. It'll do 30 damage to him, but it'll increase his damage by 40%. So he's all about that first one strike. You saw again, you know, with 45% armor absorption, or I guess it's 35 against the Black Skaven. You know, he still did 90 points of damage. You know, he does a boatload of damage without a crit against a cloth armored target. You know, it's like 140. I'm just that one strike, and if he crits, you know, it's 180. It's ridiculous.
A new round has started.
I guess we're gonna take you out, Doomweaver, because I don't know, man. I don't know what you were thinking. You just came over here like a big dummy. You weren't even using your shield. You weren't using. Like, what was the AI thinking? I don't know. Alright. Oh, they fought a demonette. That's super funny. So on maps, you have a chance to come across a neutral chaos demon who will fight anybody. If you're unlucky, it fights you. If you're lucky, it fights your enemy. And in this case, these battle chaos boys ran into a demonette over here. Oh, you can see it kick their butt. I'm so mad because I wasn't thinking. It's fine. I don't give a shit about him. He ran around my guys to fight my stupid like that. And there's the demon up on the leaderboard now, on the niche. Yeah, they'll also run around to the soft target too, and the stupid Black Skaven happens to be a soft target. So they'll run around to try to hurt his feelings, which is super annoying. And because I wasn't paying attention and wasn't super aware of where this guy was at, you know, he managed to just run around my wall to get them. But now he's stunned. Now he's going to be murdered promptly. And actually, I will just... Oh, I put myself in a position where I can't disengage. When your target's stunned, you can freely disengage, too. It doesn't cost anything, which is super nice. So that's another thing I'll do, like, if, you know, we get him here, where he's stunned, I can have my boys come in, smack him for free, because he can't stop me, he's stunned. And then just jump off. Boop. And keep on going. Come on up. Become part of the wall. And then each warp guard will continue that trend. Come up. Give him a whack. And you can see the warp guard against a stun target using Vital Strike, which is another 10% to crit. Yeah. 10%. Or, see, there you go, 27. So, I think he has a base 17 against this guy to crit him. And when you're throwing tons of attacks, you know, you're going to get the crits, you're going to get the stuns. It's just, it's super strong. It's fine, I guess. I'll go up here and just do dodge stance. When you're in the thick of the enemy, you want to use sidestep as much as you can. The warp guard can't master it, so they only get 2 dodge attempts, but, you know, you don't want your boys to get beat up too bad. Boom. They have strong crits, though. Oh, and then disengage. Come over and hang out. And then we'll just finish him off here. Oh, I failed my fear test. Doesn't matter. This means he'll have to take it again next turn. And hopefully he won't fail it then. But we'll take all his goodies. Oh, and actually, was he one of the guys I needed to kill? He was! So we'll take his stuff.
Objective completed. Objectives updated.
Thank you. And we'll come tuck ourselves over here. Yeah, you could tell it was a demonette fight because of the ripping claws debuff. If you see the enemy that's got their butt kicked somewhere and they haven't touched you yet, yeah, then you can figure it was a demon. And you know, depending on the debuffs they have, you can figure out what kind of demon it was. Ripping claw debuff will be demonettes. Anything that says Nurgle will obviously be the plague bearer. And I hate the Plague Bearers so much. Plague Bearers and the Pink Horrors are my least favorite demons. the Nurgle one, the Plague Bearer, will just smack you with so many debuffs to hit. Like, he's not... I mean, he's strong. They're all impressives, which is super annoying. But yeah, just the debuffs to hit are what make him a big pain in the butt. And then the Pink Horror will... do lots of AoE damage, like solid AoE damage too, you know, like 30 to everybody. It's like, ugh, stop that. I do not want. And I should probably heal my boy, huh? Heal my boys. Come on, there we go. So yeah. It's a scary thing too. Those demons can come out of seemingly nowhere, and you can get some bad luck with the demons, where they are just on top of you. Turn one, you know, and now you have to fight basically a free impressive that's going to help the enemy. And if you're running your army like I am, you don't have an impressive to counter. You son of a bitch. Yeah, so that's the reason why I don't personally run impressives, is because I don't want to fight against impressives. I am of the thought that, there's not a net gain, basically, to fighting with your impressive. These guys are all attention, so I'm not super scared. Boom, crit.
A new round has started.
So the enemy composition will always be equivalent to your composition. Actually, we'll come over here and charge this guy. Yep, he's got no more counterattacks. So if you take 4 heroes into a battle, the enemy will have 4 heroes. You take 4 heroes and 2 henchmen, they'll have 4 heroes and 2 henchmen. You know, it's always the same. So if you take an impressive, they take their impressive. If you don't, they won't. And even on normal difficulty, the enemy has higher damage and more wounds than you do. So my thought is, you know, why would you take your impressive? The enemy impressive is always better than yours. And now you have to use your impressive to fight their impressive. Otherwise, it's just gonna, you know, you run the risk of it flanking you or getting you and stuff. And like, I know your impressive will chew through henchmen and heroes and stuff pretty well. And you can build your henchmen and heroes to, you know, combat impressives fairly decently. But, you know, it's, they're still tough. And even, like, even how my army's set up to be super defensive, an impressive can threaten that pretty easily. Oh, he doesn't have Overwatch stance or anything. Oh, you punk. That's what you get. So, yeah. If the impressive isn't super, super good, like, I will probably use impressives in other armies. Like, I think the Ogre Bruiser for the Mercenaries is cool. I think that's a fun impressive. Skaven Rat Ogre, I think is trash. The stupid impressive starts with stupidity. It's so annoying. Like, why? Why are you punishing me? Granted, he's super strong, but yeah, starts with stupidity. Does nothing for me. I don't want him. The Crypt Ghoul for the undead is okay. I don't hate him. Like, I was using him in my for funs playthrough, you know? He's not awful. But, you know. If I wanted to optimize my warband, I probably would not use him. You know, he's not optimal. Because he does take two hero slots, too. Like, if you take your impressive, you're gonna miss out on a hero, at least. So, yeah, that's my thought on impressives. They're typically not worth it, I think. I'd rather just play in the games without them. Because otherwise the game becomes about the impressives. You got a counter, or you got a, no, I mean, you have to counter the impressive. It becomes around finding and countering him. Otherwise, he's going to get you. Even if you're impressive, because, yeah, even if you have your impressive out there and you're, you know, tearing up the enemy warband, all it takes is their impressive to come in and start killing your guys. You know, they're not going to feel the effects of that. Of having their guys put out of action. It's not like you're ever going to fight the same warband. The computer doesn't keep these warbands and like, oh, you know, you robbed that warband of all their gear and, you know, knocked all their guys out of action. That warband's going to be weaker now. No, that's never going to happen. You're always fighting a fresh warband that's of equivalent strength to you. So. Is he the guy? No, I need him. Let's go get him. Hey there, man. Oh, careful approach. Tricky, tricky boy. All right, there we go. I'll get him. I'm going to get him. Oh, I am not going to get him. I talk so highly of you, Globedeer, and you're letting me down. Oh, there you go. We winged him. Ah, whatever. Actually. Here. We can do this. Boom. 131 damage. Rawr. Oh, take his token.
Objective completed.
Oh, and actually, here, we can do this, too. Rah! Execute. See, he can do the things. But as you said, you know, he can't take a hit, and then he's just kind of... whatever. Like, I'd rather have two Globedeers, and then they rout. So you can see, even though I wasn't playing perfectly, we still... I would say it was a resounding defeat. Although, I mean, I guess to be fair, they did have to fight a demonette in there at one point, too. So, I mean, take it with a grain of salt, but I mean, every fight is about like that. All right, he's almost 10. And this is what I'm looking at here. So I'm mostly doing missions now. For just in chance. So, like when I pick a mission to do on the campaign map, I'm looking for good, exceptional, you know, stuff, goods, because I'm trying to get enchants to kind of round out my warband and make them all that they can be. And accuracy. That's what I'm missing from my boys is some solid enchants. And we're getting there. We're getting a lot of them, but there is still a lot to go. Like ideally on the Night Runners and my Lord here, I want the mark of weapon skill. +4 weapon skill. It's gonna up his hit. It's going to up his melee resistance, which is a big thing. An extra 4% melee resistance. You know, it's great. Like on a shield, I'm looking for shielding, rune of shielding, 12% melee resistance. I don't have it, but I've been picking up a lot of shields from the enemies that give me, you know, those effects too. What's he got? He's got iron. I just picked one up. So yeah, that's my Skaven warband. Let's go ahead and
new shipment request.
Yeah, strength.
Market stock has been replenished.
And get that light wounds taken care of. And you can see I have a ton of money, so I like at a certain point in the game, like gold becomes trivial. It's really weird. And then, like, I would love to get these reputations up to get these things, but you know, it ends up not being a huge deal. Oh, and I'm short, so I won't get it. Like, I don't actively collect weird stone and maps anymore. It's like I let the whatever the computer picks up at the end of the match, you know, fill my coffers. and then that eventually that ends up being enough to do a couple. Actually, I will. I'll send stuff to him. What do I need? 100 something. There we go. 140. Rep. Get me rank 3. Nope, not quite. So I need 30. Oh. 31. Oh, but it's 260. I'm an idiot. So two more. Boop. I can't count. There we go.
You are becoming famous.
There we go. And that'll, you know, throw a couple enchants at me. The training books are super useful too. Just to help maximize your boys. But yeah, nothing I'm super worried about. So yeah, that's my Skaven here. So yeah, skill wise. I do Master Swarm. I think everyone has Mastery Swarm. Obviously the henchmen don't get mastery of anything, but it's just 10% hit and crit chance when you're engaged with the same target with an ally. Super good. He's got Awareness, mastered, extra melee resistance, he's got Avoid, extra dodge. Shield Specialist just picked up because it was cheap and it's extra melee resistance and, you know, what else was it going to take? Sidestep, because he needs it to be a super tanky guy. Vital Strike, just because, you know, you'll have the extra point. You might as well pick up an ability to use it. And since I'm going for crit, you know, that's what I want. So he has a base 26% chance to crit. I also picked up Courage with him, I think with a skill book. Just to help. So you can see, like, he's got an 80% chance to pass fear and terror tests, and that's, you know, without any kind of debuff. Like, I want to say the undead have some debuffs in there that will do that, lower your chance to pass those tests. He does have a purple pendant, and then, I mean, honestly, I guess I don't know. Probably courage. Maybe evasion, just to do evasion. Yeah. Maybe. Yeah, you can see stat-wise, 135% chance to dodge. Reduces chance to be hit by 77%. Yeah, he's all about not being hit. The Night Runners are both the same. So they have Swarm, they have Avoid. They have Awareness, but they don't have that mastered because, yeah, they're never going to have the intelligence to do that. The Alertness to do that. Although, I guess if I could have waited, tried to get a mental skill book, and have done it, but, you know, that's a long time. instead, Master Shield Specialist, which is in the realm, and it gives them the 10% melee resistance. So, you know, whatever. They have Vital Strike as well as Sidestep, and then they have Combat Savvy as their secondary skill. The Warp Guard, I do Swarm, Avoid, Nerves of Steel, because they won't have as high leadership as like him. The Night Runners have really low leadership too. Yeah, it's bad. Like I said, it's important to wear the pendants. And then they get Shield Specialization, of course, too. They go Vital Strike as well, Sidestep, and then their secondary skill, all the Warp Guard have Insult, which will lower the melee resistance of a target. Where this comes in useful is if I'm fighting another super tank. It happens a lot against, like, the Mercenaries. They can field some heavy guys and heavy armor with high melee resistance and stuff like that. So this just helps with fighting those guys, lowering their melee resistance, make it easier for me to swarm over them and hit them. The Night Runners are the same. The Globedeer, I do go for potent globes. If I were to rebuild him, I would probably get rid of potent globes. I'd probably get rid of what's the other one? Poison Expert. He doesn't have a passive. Right, Poison Expert and Potent Globes. I would not take these two skills. I don't use his globes offensively enough anymore, honestly. I don't know what I would take another. You know, I haven't considered it, but that's what I would do. I do use Bullseye because it's super good. It makes him super shooty. Same with Quick Reload and Trick Shot. I would probably max out things like that, like Trick Shot, and there's a couple of ones. Increases his hit chance if he's at higher elevation, stuff like that. Just make him more shooty. You get Poison Globes, which, I mean, it does damage. You do fight guys with super high ranged resistance, so they're hard to shoot, or they have super high armor, so you don't do a ton of damage against them. In those instances, poison's not bad, but yeah, it's not really that much better, and it does create an area that's bad for your guys too, so whatever. Infused Globe, super great. That's the Healing Globe, Warp Globe. Like I said, it's a good debuff globe. It doesn't, you know, and you don't need poison. Like, the only thing poison resistance his abilities help with is poison globes, and if I ever wanted to actually melee attack somebody with the Weeping Blades. You know, if I was doing something like that, which I probably never will. And then Enrich Globe is, you know, the buff. And the mastery of those just increases the duration. So maybe mastery of those, but I didn't think it was necessary. And then my boy here, the Black Skaven. That's the passive, the Black Skaven passive. He just gets that for free. He's got Strider, extra hit chance on the charge attacks, extra charge range, extra crit chance on charges. Mighty Charge, Mastered, does a ton of damage, bypasses parry chance. And then Black Hunger, just increased melee damage, and that's what I will probably mastery next. I think he'll get 8 skill points when he levels up, so probably that and Bolt Charge. So he can charge from super far away. It's all about that. The one strike, one hit, one kill. And Ogre, I don't care about you, Ogre. You do nothing for me, sir. So yeah, that's my Skaven Warband, and they are, like I said, they are successful. I don't know if you can bring up their stats. No? I don't know. Like I said, they haven't lost a match. They're 100 some days in, and you know they crush face. So thanks for watching, guys. I hope that was, you know, informative. Like if you want to build Skaven or something like that, you know, if you want me to go in more in depth on like how to level them up and stuff like that, let me know down in the comments. But it's, you know, that's how I built my Skaven Warband, as a kind of a bulwark that the enemy crashes against, with my back line taking them out, and then that wall surrounding and crushing the enemies. Yeah, it's good times. But yeah, so thanks for watching, guys, and we will see you in the next one. Goodbye.